Now about the normal process of sex hormone secretion. Hypothalamus secrete gonadotropin-releasing hormone. This gonadotropin-releasing hormone stimulates pituitary gland. Pituitary gland secrete gonadotropins, its luteinizing hormone and follicle-stimulating hormone. These two hormones stimulate gonads, for men its testes, for women its ovaries, and now there is a major difference. In testes, luteinizing hormone acts on Leydig cells and stimulates testosterone production. It's easy to remember because of first three letters in luteinizing hormone. Luteinizing hormone stimulates Leydig cells and stimulates testosterone production. And follicular-stimulating hormone acts on seminiferous tubules to promote spermatogenesis. It's easy to remember too because follicular-stimulating hormone, seminiferous tubules, and spermatogenesis. In women, luteinizing hormones acts on thicker cells and stimulate androgens production. And these androgens are going to granulosa cells, where follicular-stimulating hormones stimulate granulosa cells to convert androgens to estrogens. Also, we know that there are three estrogens hormones, it's estrone, estriol, and the most potent estradiol. But now there is the question where estrogens in men synthesize. It's a curious fact that androgens are a major source of estrogens for men and postmenopausal women. This happens because of the specific feature of sex hormone metabolism, their conversion in peripheral blood. When androgens, testosterone and his precursor androstenedione reach peripheral blood, they can undergo extrahepatic aromatization. This extrahepatic aromatization occurs mostly in adipose tissue, but also it can occur in bone cells and results in conversion of androgens to estrogens. Why is this process called aromatization? For example, when testosterone molecule by enzyme aromatase is converted into estradiol, non-aromatic arena of testosterone molecule became aromatic in estradiol molecule. That's why this process is called aromatization. So we discuss how sex hormones synthesize, but how they act and how to regulate their activity. We know that both estrogens and androgens are lipophilic molecules, so they can freely diffuse across membranes and act on target tissue. That's why in their free form they are very active, because they have very high diffusion rate. And to control their activity, organisms must control their diffusion rate. So to limit their diffusion rate, in plasma they are bound to proteins, weakly to albumin and tightly to a specific regulatory protein that calls sex hormone binding globulin. And if they are bound to proteins, they lose their lipophilic properties, so they cannot freely diffuse across membranes and act on target tissue. And we know that albumin is a multifunctional protein that also binds steroid hormones, calcium, etc., so it's not a specific regulator of sex hormones activity. So if the level of sex hormones increase, we don't expect that in response to this, liver will increase albumin's production. But what liver will increase is the production of sex hormone binding globulin. In literature, you can find that albumins have high affinity for estradiol and sex hormone binding globulin for testosterone. But actually, the difference in this affinity isn't so substantial. And what is really important and high yield to understand is that if there is elevation of only estrogens or only androgens or both of them are elevated, the response will be always increasing the production of sex hormone binding globulin. The mechanism of hypogonadism is that in chronic liver disease and especially in cirrhosis, detoxification function is impaired, and decrease in detoxification leads to increase in blood ammonia level and also to increase in blood aromatic amino acids as tyrosine, phenylalanine and tryptophan. They're called aromatic because they have an aromatic ring in their structure, and these aromatic amino acids play a crucial role in sex hormone dysfunction and also in hepatic encephalopathy. The problem is that these aromatic amino acids can cross blood-brain barrier through large neutral amino acids transporter, and when they cross blood-brain barrier, the level of cerebral amino acids increase, and this leads to an excessive synthesis of false neurotransmitters as tyramine and octopamine. These false neurotransmitters can displace true neurotransmitters from presynaptic vesicles, thereby disrupting neuron-neuron signaling. For example, when phenylalanine crosses blood-brain barrier by hydroxylation, he converts into tyrosine, and tyrosine by decarboxylation is converted into tyramine, and tyramine can be converted by hydroxylation into octopamine or dopamine. And dopamine can be converted into norepinephrine and epinephrine. Dopamine, norepinephrine, and epinephrine are true neurotransmitters that in normal condition transported to secretory vesicles and secreted from presynaptic neuron and act on postsynaptic neuron. And what happens in cirrhosis is that because there is increase in aromatic amino acids level in the brain, particularly in phenylalanine level, this causes rise in tyrosine, that subsequently causes rise in tyramine, so there is rise in precursor of normal neurotransmitters. And the reason why is this depicted in formulas, because you can see how similar the structure of these substances. For example, tyramine and dopamine, or octopamine and norepinephrine, and because their structure are very similar, tyramine and octopamine can displace true neurotransmitters as dopamine, norepinephrine, and epinephrine from secretory vesicles, and instead, for example, dopamine, tyramine is secreted from presynaptic neuron, and he acts differently, thereby disrupting neuron-neuron signaling. That's why they're called false neurotransmitters, because they have similar structure, but they act differently compared to the true neurotransmitters. And here is the central concept of pathogenesis of hypogonadism. Pituitary gland secrete hormone prolactin, and this prolactin secretion is controlled by dopamine. Dopamine inhibits prolactin secretion. An important feature of prolactin for our discussion is that prolactin decreases hypothalamus secretion of gonadotropin-releasing hormone. And because in cirrhosis there is increase in the level of false neurotransmitters, they substitute dopamine from secretory vesicles, so dopamine secretion decreases, and this causes increase in prolactin synthesis. And because prolactin level increase, the secretion of gonadotropin-releasing hormone by hypothalamus decreases. This causes decrease in follicular-stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone. So there will be progressive decrease in gonad stimulation that eventually results in hypogonadism. To eliminate circulating estrogens and androgens, they must be first of all be delivered to the liver and then to undergo glucuronidation, and only after glucuronidation they can be excreted by the kidneys. Because estrogens and androgens are lipophilic molecules, and lipophilic molecules cannot be excreted by the kidney, so by glucuronidation liver gives to them hydrophilic properties, and only after this they can be excreted. So what happens in cirrhosis is that in cirrhosis there is decrease in live hepatocytes, and with decrease in hepatocyte quantity the glucuronidation rate decreases, and with decreased glucuronidation rate more estrogens will remain in their lipophilic form in which they cannot be excreted by the kidneys. So this will cause decrease in excretion and rise in blood estrogens and androgens level. Also, portal hypertension stimulates development of portosystemic shunts that diverts blood flow away from the liver, thereby reducing hepatic perfusion, and the more severe is portal hypertension, the more developed are shunts, so the more blood bypassing liver, and with blood, estrogens and androgens also bypass liver, so they cannot even be potentially converted to hydrophilic form to be excreted. This also will cause decrease in excretion and increase in blood estrogens and androgens level. And this increase in blood androgens level lead to increase in peripheral conversion of androgens into estrogens in adipose tissue. This causes decrease in androgens and rise in estrogens level. For example, after peripheral conversion for every 3 estrogens molecules, there is 1 androgen molecule. And this high estrogens level stimulates production of sex hormone binding globulin. And this sex hormone binding globulin binds 3 estrogens, but also it binds 3 androgens. And as a result, estrogens level decreased, but remains still very high, but androgens level became very low. So that's how sex hormone binding globulin production can aggravate hypoandrogenemia. And as a result, we see that there is substantial hyperestrogenemia, but also there is hypoandrogenemia that causes clinical symptoms. And this hyperestrogenemia results in clinical symptoms. For example, spider telangiectasia, angiomata, and palmar erythema. Spider telangiectasia is a central pulsating dilated arterial with small vasodilated vessels around it. The mechanism is that increase in blood estrogens level induce vascularization. This mechanism also seen in pregnant women. And estrogens cause local vasodilation. So these two effects results in formation of spider telangiectasia and palmar erythema. So hypoandrogenemia is caused by several factors. First of all, by decrease in gonadotropin secretion that results in testicular atrophy. The second factor is androgens' peripheral conversion into estrogens by extrahepatic aromatization. And the third factor is liver production of sex hormone-binding globulin in response to high estrogens level that also binds free androgens, thereby aggravating hypoandrogenemia. And hypoandrogenemia results in clinical symptoms as erectile dysfunction and decreased libido. Also, there is one well-known symptom of cirrhosis that is related to estrogens-androgens disbalance, and this is gynecomastia. Gynecomastia is benign proliferation of breast gland in males. The mechanism is that in liver cirrhosis there is high estrogens level, and estrogens stimulate breast tissue proliferation. And the factor that inhibits breast tissue growth is testosterone, but testosterone level is low, so this altered estrogen-testosterone ratio stimulates breast tissue growth and causes gynecomastia.